Hey everyone, today we'll be talking. I'm sorry, is it fine if I record a video?
No, no problem.
Thank you so much. Usually, when you're building a system, an engineering system, there's actually some sort of background behind it. We'll be taking a real-world example of opening a restaurant. Let's see how that happens. Let's take an example of a pizza parlor, and we have just one chef. There comes a point, though, that one chef cannot handle all the orders that all the new customers are bringing in. If you think like a manager, the first thing that you're going to do is ask the chef to work harder. And you can pay them more. Put in more money, they give you more output. You want to optimize processes and increase throughput using the same resource. When you think of the chef as a computer, and put this in technical terms, it's called vertical scaling. Speaking of optimizing processes, you can do some things beforehand. When you get an order, you don't need to actually make the pizza base. That can be pre-made, preparing beforehand at non-peak hours. The reason you want to do this at non-peak hours is because you don't want a regular order to come in and your chef being busy making the pizza bases. Somewhere around 4 a.m. in the night is really good because you surely won't have any pizza orders that time.
Now that the system is set up, let's make it resilient.
Let's say that the chef calls sick one day. At this point, your business is in trouble because there won't be any business that day. This person is a single point of failure. So what you can do then is hire a backup chef. In case the chef doesn't come, you employ them for that day only and you pay them, of course. In this case, the chance of you losing out on business is really low because you have not just one chef, but also the backup. Keep backups and avoid single points of failure. For computers, it's something like a master-slave architecture, the master chef, and you have a slave chef, which is a little odd to say. So that's what we need. Now, if your business keeps growing every time, then you better make that backup chef a full-time chef. In fact, hire more chefs. Let's say instead of one chef, you have now 10 chefs and a few in backup also, just in case. Hire more resources, which maps to horizontal scaling. Horizontal scaling is buying more machines of similar types to get more work done. Let's say we have three of our chefs over here, 1, 2, and 3. They have some specialties.
Here's a question. You have chefs 1 and 3 who are experts at making pizzas, and chef 2's expertise is garlic bread. If you have two types of incoming orders, which is pizza and garlic bread, how would you route them?
What you can do is randomly assign them orders. So if you have garlic bread, it can go to chef 1, you can take pizza and send it to chef 2. But this is not the most efficient way to use your employees. You can build on their strengths and route all garlic bread orders to chef 2. And all pizza orders to chef 1 and 3. This makes the system a little simpler because anytime you need to make a change in the recipe for garlic bread, you just need to notify chef 2. Anytime you need the status of any order on garlic bread, chef 2 is the person you ask. You can actually make a team, like a team of chefs over here who are specialists in garlic bread. Maybe you just need 3 chefs over here for garlic bread because the number of orders is going to be a little lesser. For pizzas, you need the remaining 7 chefs distributed into a team of 3 and 4. They're good at making pizzas and they're getting all the pizza orders. What you're doing is you're scaling this team at a different rate compared to these two teams and also dividing responsibilities. So we have something called a microservice architecture. You have all your responsibilities well-defined over here. There's nothing outside your business use case that you handle. So that is point number 5. At this point, your pizza shop is actually doing really well because it's able to handle all orders within time. And it also has specialists for everything, which you can scale easily. This business is scalable to a large extent. But what if there is an electricity outage in this pizza shop? You won't have business that day. What if you lose your license for a day? You won't have business that day. So what you want to do is you want to distribute. I mean, you don't want to put all your eggs in one basket, not even in one shop. You want to buy a separate shop in a different place, which can also deliver pizzas. Maybe it takes more time. Maybe the number of chefs there is lesser, but at least you have a backup. So we take backup to a different level over here and open a new shop. This is probably the biggest step where we introduce a lot of complexity to the system because there sometimes needs to be communication between these shops. You need to be able to route your requests. I mean, you get a request for a pizza. You need to be able to tell that, should I order it to this or should I send the order over here? A distributed system. And one very clear advantage that we can have here is that Any orders which are very close to this, which are local to its range, can be served by this shop. In a large-scale distributed system, let's say Facebook, you get requests from all around the world. To give quick response times, you need some sort of local servers everywhere. And that's what we are doing. We are distributing our system so that it's more fault-tolerant and also gives quicker response times. Let's say you have the old shops, Pizza Shop 1 and 2, and you have delivery agents and you have customers. Every time a customer makes a request, they need to either send it to one or two. But the customer is not going to be taking that responsibility. So you want to send it to somebody else, maybe a central place which just routes requests. And you don't just want to send these requests randomly. You have a very clear parameter. How much time does it take for the customer to get the pizza? That's it, that's your parameter. If you send it to Pizza Shop 1, it's a really popular shop, maybe it takes 1 hour for it to wait in queue, plus 5 minutes to make, plus 10 minutes to deliver from PS1 to the customer. Over here, Pizza Shop 2 has a really short wait time. The total time required here is 1 hour 5 minutes, which is less than the 1 hour 15 minutes required over here. So the central authority should actually send it over here. So, and as long as it's getting real-time updates, it can make intelligent business decisions, which means more money. This thing that routes requests in a smart way is called a load balancer. You can assume why.
The system is now fault-tolerant, but how do you make it flexible to change?
At this point, you can almost tell that the delivery agent and the pizza shop have nothing in common. I mean, it could be a pizza shop, it could be a burger shop for the delivery agent. They just want to deliver their goods as quickly as possible to the customer. And similarly, the pizza shop doesn't care whether it's a delivery agent or the customer themselves who come and pick it up. So we are seeing some sort of separation of responsibilities. Instead of having the same managers managing the pizza shop and the delivery agents, you want to separate that out. It's called decoupling the system. Separating out concerns so that you can handle separate systems more efficiently. Let's say Pizza Shop 1 has a faulty oven. Their churning rate goes down. If you have a faulty bike, maybe that particular delivery agent's order times increase. So at this point, what you want is you want to log everything. You want to see at what time something happened and what is the next event and so on and so forth. And also you want to be taking those events, condensing them, finding sense out of those events. So that's metrics. The final and most important point is to keep your system extensible. As a backend engineer, you don't want to rewrite all this code again and again to serve a different purpose. For example, this delivery agent doesn't need to know that they're delivering a pizza. It can be a burger tomorrow. And if you think about Amazon, earlier they used to deliver only parcels. And the reason why you can scale out your business is because you want to decouple everything to make sure that your system is extensible. What we have done is taken a business scenario, try to find solutions to all the problems that it came up with, and then just map them into technical terms. Now, if you think of these, they are solutions in themselves for the technical counterparts of these problems.
Finally, we have managed to scale our restaurant. At a high level, we can now define what kind of problems we face and how we'll be solving them. This is known as high-level design. There's a counterpart to this, which is called low-level design. Let's briefly talk about that.
The difference between high-level system design and low-level system design. So high-level is what we talk about on this channel, you know, deploying on servers, figuring out how two systems will be interacting with each other. Low-level system design has a lot more to do with how you're actually going to code this stuff. Like, making classes, making objects, the functions, the signatures. These things are pretty important if you are a senior engineer. And even if you're not, if you want to go to the senior engineering level, you need to know about how do you write efficient and clean code. The load balancer, microservice architecture, and a few other videos are there in the description. And if you want notifications for the future videos, you can hit the subscribe button. Until next time then, I'll see you.